breathe a little bit, and it gives me a chance to share some stories and even take questions from the audience. So I do hope all of you will make it to the show. I love acoustic shows.
And I have been been introduced to Kelly Lang about a year or so ago when she came out with her CDs, Old Soul, and it just touched my heart because these are songs that are like right to the core of what I love. And we've talked on my show a couple of times about her songs, so I hope that you brought a couple of those to purchase because they're... And so I want to hear your story behind Midnight Train to Georgia, too, because that's phenomenal. And
that.
She's got a new single that she'll talk about. And by the way, I want to get that interview clip with you for my show coming up.
You got it.
And dear Michelle Wright, oh my goodness, what an amazing performer.
I've got to tell you that Michelle was just part of our benefit that we did in Nashville here this past month at Third and Lindsley. It's called Country for a Cause, where we raise money for the Children's Hospital at Vanderbilt. And because of her and so many of our friends that came, we were able to give them a check last week for $60,000.
Oh, wow.
Thank you, Michelle, for that.
And I'll just make a quick statement, too, and then I'll let you guys. I don't know if you guys realized it at the time, but I've been following all this with the lead up to the Country for a Cause, and they posted a picture on Facebook of both TG and Kelly and Michelle together, and I said, how ironic. These three are going to be in the same room for our group today, and here they are.
Yes.
So how about that?
We're happy to be here.
So glad to be
here. Does anybody, now they'll ask questions, and I'm going to hold this up so I can get it recorded too, so I can play back on my show. But anybody have any questions or anything, or any comments at this point?
Don't be shy.
I want to start. I want to be the first one.
Sure.
Yeah. Back when you were in the recording business, and yeah. I guess before you became TG, you had... Had an opportunity to work with Hitsville and the Motown guys. How did that work out as a rising artist?
I was a record executive at that time with RCA Victor out of New York, and I was working nationally for them, and had the chance to tour with Elvis and with John Denver and so many other, Charlie Pride, and back then Porter and Norma Jean. It wasn't Porter and Dolly then. So it worked out great. I have to say that I actually was discovered by Barry Gordy at Motown. People are in shock when they hear that because he's known as a pop guy and a rhythm and blues guy, but he has a love for country. And it worked out really great for me, the first record that I ever put out after I signed with Motown or Hitsville. Was Devil in the Bottle, went number one. And from then on, we haven't looked back. It's just been an incredible ride. But it was a great way to break into the business. And it was very difficult to break into the business being an executive because you just didn't cross that line to become an artist if you were an executive.
Yes. But a lot of people did,
first.
Matt Davis and Kenny Rogers did the same.
My dear friends Kenny and Mac were also promotion men before they became artists. And Tony Orlando.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Yeah.
It worked out great.
No, that's good. That's good. I just
had
to know how Motown worked.
You know? Oh, yeah, man, I'm telling you. I actually was on the Motown 25 special. That was the night that Michael Jackson did the moonwalk for the first time. And I'm standing in the wings, and I watch him walk on stage, and I kept thinking, how is the floor moving? And it wasn't moving.
It was
an incredible night. We filmed that at the Santa Monica Civic Center in California. It was a great night, but great memories of Motown.
Oh, great.
Anybody else? I would love for you to tell us about your new single that you just released, and it's going to be featured on my show. It's so new, we haven't even had a chance to play it yet.
It's just 2 days old.
That's exactly right. But,
it's a baby. I went to a Brooks and Dunn concert. Have you all ever seen Brooks and Dunn in concert? They're really amazing. So my daughter wanted to go with me, and I went... I love them, but that was her passion to go, and so I took her, and I didn't think I would have an experience, a spiritual experience, by all means, by seeing them sing Red Dirt Road. Like that's not a come to Jesus kind of song, you know? But he said that's where I found Jesus in the song, and when he said that, I have chills now. Mm-hmm, look at him. Mm-hmm. I lump in my throat, and I'm like, what is that? You know, like, that's not a spiritual kind of song. A few minutes later, he sang Believe, And I just burst out in tears. Everybody was just like, just emotionally really moved. And I thought, I'd love to bottle that. Like, what is that? Because don't we all have those experiences with a song or something that we don't even realize why we're having chills, but we're not even cold? So I came home, got in my pool. Yes. I was telling Michelle I write most of my songs in the swimming pool.
Nice.
When I get really calm and quiet. And I started thinking about my dad who had passed, and a red bird came over me and just sat there and looked at me, and I'm like, Dad, you know, you hear that, you know, you think, is there a connection with that? And I also notice in my life that I see 1111 a lot in my life, and maybe a white feather where there's no bird. So I just started thinking, there's got to be a universal spiritual connection with some of these things. And so I wrote the song. It's the conclusion that I came to. It's called I Think It's Jesus. And it's not a gospel song in particular. I think it's just a human song. I think it's just a human spiritual experience.
Golly.
Oh, I pitched it to Dolly Parton when I first wrote it. Hi, Scott. And when I sent it to Dolly, I didn't know if I would even hear back from her. She's very busy, as y'all can imagine. And in the meantime, Lori Morgan called me, and she was getting ready to go in the studio and record some songs. She'd already chosen two songs that I had recently written, or not recently, but had written for her upcoming album. And she asked if I had any more that I could play for her. I said, well, I just wrote one, but I can't play it for you. She goes, well, if y'all know Lori, if you tell her no, that's when she wants it more, right? I said, I can't pitch this to you. And she says, well, I definitely want to hear this. So I reluctantly played it, and she's recorded it as well. So in the meantime, Dolly wrote me a beautiful letter. And she said, Kelly, this song is fantastic. I'm so proud of you. I'm not cutting a gospel album at this moment, but when I do, I'm going to circle back around. You know, even if she never did, just honestly, the thought of having her, my hero, write me a letter was just super, you know. So we put the song out a couple of days ago. It's really just, it came out July 7th, and it's really resonating, and a lot of people are really writing me beautiful notes about it, so I'm really excited about it. I'd like for y'all to look it up. It's I Think It's Jesus, okay?
It's beautiful.
Well, go ahead.
I was just curious, so you write the song by yourself?
Yeah.
These songs, that's to me is... You know, I have to have a co-writer because I just second-guess myself all. In the good old days when we'd write on paper, I'd have like a pile of paper in the corner. That's no good. So that's fabulous that you have gift and that ability to write that by yourself.
Thank you so very much.
That's a real talent.
Well, one of the things that I love about the show that I put together is that everybody has some strong faith foundations,
mm-hmm.
and there's a place on my show that there's a regular feature called Classic Country Saturday Night Gets Religion, so I can bring those faith-based songs because it is such a core to country music.
It is,
and there's a place for it. And Michelle recorded a live version, which I featured recently. It's such a soulful version of People Get Ready, and
I love that song.
What inspired you to record that? Is that a regular in your shows, or can you tell us more about that?
We do play it, certainly. Not all the time, but just depending on what I feel like adding into the set. But, you know, I have to say, TG, it's just so cool, your whole Motown connection, and, well, your whole history is just fascinating. We hung a little bit after I talked did a bit on his radio show, and he was just sharing a little bit, just a small amount of his career. I think you said you might write us a book someday.
I'm writing the book. I'm just starting it now.
Yeah, I can't wait to read it. And so I grew up just across the board from Detroit,
okay,
and Motown was also a very strong musical influence on me.
Yeah.
And so when Arista Records was putting together a gospel album, I asked if I could record People Get Ready, and they said, because it's not a real gospel song, it's just, but to me it's spiritual and certainly hints towards faith, and that was my choice, and it's wonderful to have that to sing on stage. People really respond to it.
Well, you make it a religious experience.
Yeah. I have a funny story about Motown in particular. My daughter, both of our daughters are very musically inclined, but my youngest one, she was a teenager, and she thinks she knows it all at that point, right? Don't they all? And I said, there was a song that came on, and I said, that sounds like Motown. You know, it's not a Motown song, but it sounded very Motown sounding. They've got a vibe, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And she goes, no, it does not. And I said, you don't even know what Motown is. Yes, I do. It's a boy group.
I was like,
you know everything.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, she knows it all.
Does anybody else have another question or something?
Yeah. This
like
is
to
your
share?
Chance.
TG. Did y'all
go ahead.
Were y'all musical growing up, young, when you were little or
something? I actually started off opening for the Beach Boys, believe it or not, when I was a teenager.
Wow.
And
how much are you?
That's good music back then.
And so I started off in the pop end, trying to make it as a pop artist, and I just didn't connect. And then became a country artist strictly through the encouragement of a dear friend, Waylon Jennings, who said to me, get out of the record business, get out of the suit, and quit pushing records and start being a country singer. And I took his advice. But yeah, I grew up in a home where my mom was a strong Christian and was a piano teacher and a gospel singer. And so music was in our home from day one when I arrived in the world. So I was exposed to it very early, and I knew very early in my life that I wanted music as my life.
And for myself, my dad was Conway Twitty's road manager for 25 years. So I was born into it. I was always around it from the time I was 1 year old. And, you know, it was nothing for Conway or Loretta or George Jones or whatever.
You want to write a book.
Right.
No, she's
got my book.
Oh, she's got my book.
I've read the book.
Oh,
great.
Thank you. I'm
glad. Did you bring any of those with you?
Yeah, I brought a few books with me. But anyway, I grew up around it, and I wrote my first song at 6 years old and became really engrossed in it because...
silly.
I used to love sitting back behind the stage watching Conway go on the stage. The vibe of that was so enormous. It was so weird. Like, it would be like thunderous. And he was a quiet man. He would just walk out there and not even speak. Have y'all ever seen him in concert?
Yes.
Hello, darling. Everybody, ah! It's so nuts. But I wanted what that was. My talent wasn't near what it should have been to have even had, you know, the confidence to get on stage then, but the desire was there because I thought it was super cool to live that lifestyle, and I just loved being in his presence. It was cool.
A little footnote before we get to your question. I talked to Joni Lee just recently.
Oh, yeah.
And she wanted to be here. She just recently had some surgery,
yeah,
but she sends her best.
Yeah, and she's wonderful.
But you've got a little quick story behind the song that you wrote in tribute to Conway.
Yes. Oh, well, I hate to hog the conversation here. Okay.
So, I enjoy this as much as
Conway. I adored him. I just absolutely loved him. And I wish... in hindsight, that I'd had more opportunity to speak to him about music, because I wasn't as involved with the music business when he passed as I am now. And so TG and I were just dating. He lived in Knoxville. I lived in Hendersonville, Tennessee. And so we would meet up like in Cookville and have dinner and just go our separate ways after dinner. So we were talking about our love for Conway one night and how much we missed him. He'd been gone maybe 10 years at that point. I don't know. And on the way home, I started having this song come to me, and I'm like, I gotta pull over because I need to write it down. I'm gonna lose my train of thought if I don't. So I pulled over on that side of the interstate, and I was looking for a paper and a pen, and all I could find was a napkin and a lip liner. Ladies, it works, right?
Yep.
So I wrote this whole song called Goodbye Darling in tribute to Conway's Hello Darling, and I gave it to them as a gift the next day, the family. And it's gone on to really do well, and the Conway fans are just so rabid and kind and supportive of that. So I'm really happy about that song.
Oh, and it's been featured on my show a number of times, so no doubt about that. And
let me footnote. TG said, I called him. He called me. He goes, where are you, honey? Are you home yet? And I said, no, I'm on the side of the road. And he goes, oh, dear God, I got to send somebody to come get me. I said, no, I'm just writing a song. I'm good. You know?
Chris, you had a question?
Well, we were talking this morning in the bus that you used to do a show on XM with for Elvis Presley and the friendship you had with him. So how did you, but you don't do it anymore, you do your own show, which I've listened to. So how did you meet Elvis?
I was a runaway at 15. My father was very strict, did not allow music in the house. And I knew then that I wanted it for my life. So I had to leave and climbed out of the back window at 15 and hitchhiked to Memphis, living in alleyways and eating out of garbage cans, actually, to survive. And one night I had a friend that was working at a skating rink, and he invited me to go skating for free. So I hitchhiked out to the skating rink, and by midnight I'm standing outside, and they'd cut the lights off, and these Cadillacs start pulling up. And Elvis gets out from behind the wheel of the lead car, and he walks right over to me, and he says, "Where are you going?" And I said, "Well, they're closing the rink down. I'm leaving." He said, "No, they're opening it up for me." And he invited me in to roller skate with him. And so we roller skated until about 4 or 5 a.m. And then after that, he said, "Are you hungry?" And of course, I was always hungry then. He said, "Let's go up to the house and have a sandwich." So he puts me in the car, and he drives me up his driveway. And I'm pinching myself all the way, going, "I'm going to wake up any minute, and this is not really happening." So we went up to the house, spent another couple of 2 or 3 hours shooting pool and listening to music and eating peanut butter and banana sandwiches.
So it is true.
And he asked me for my phone number, and I thought, yeah, right, you'll never remember who I am. The next day I get a phone call. "You want to go to the movies?" And man, that was the start of the friendship that altered my life.
The upswing of that, though, is from eating out of garbage cans, my cooking is an upgrade.
Elvis was just one of those rare individuals who had no ego. He was just a country boy that happened to be at the right place at the right time, and it happened for him. And he always would say to me, "I don't understand how I got here." He was always in shock of who he became. And so therefore his feet was always on the ground and had such a love of God. One of the things about Elvis a lot of people don't know is he had a photographic memory. Whatever he would read or hear, he retained. He would actually sit and quote the scriptures to me without opening the Bible, and would give me his interpretation of the scriptures. And those were those moments that I would treasure forever. That's how I met him at 15, and it turned into a friendship, and it was destined. It was written in the book a long time ago that that day would happen.
So how old was he? I mean, because you knew who
he was.
He was
in his 20s. He was young.
He was 25.
Just gotten out of the army, and he just, I was a little bit in awe the first few times I was around him. But after a while, I realized he was just a man. And he became a, gave me my first tour bus to get me started. And he believed in me, and that's what encouraged me to try to succeed, was his belief in me.
Wow.
So as a former record promoter and being tied to
he
RCA.
He was my artist too later on.
Exactly. And we just want you to know that we actually took a tour of the RCA studio yesterday.
Oh, yeah.
We all recorded a song. It's an Elvis song. So if you've got any ties to record companies or anything.
Yeah.
The press.
We have our own label. If you mention RCA Studios, I was in that studio with Elvis on more than one occasion when he would record.
Yeah.
And I'll never forget the night that he was doing a song called Guitar Man in that studio. And Al Chuki, who was the engineer, said, "You know, there's a guy that's a great picker that you need to get in here to play this guitar part." And I thought, "Who is this going to be?" And he said, "This guy is the greatest guitar player, and he's going to be a hit artist." Well, the guy came in, and it was Jerry Reed. And Elvis was a very funny person when people approached him, so he didn't know how to react to certain people. We were standing in the hallway at RCA, and Jerry turned the corner all the way down to the end of the hall, and started running toward Elvis. And he jumped up on Elvis and wrapped his legs around his waist and his arms around his neck, and he said, "Elvis, I love you." And we all thought, this is either going to be funny or it's going to be disastrous. And Elvis started laughing, and from then on, Elvis loved
Jerry. Did he say he was the prettiest man he'd ever seen?
Yeah, he said, "Elvis, you're the prettiest man I've ever seen."
That's the truth.
They became instant friends. But that's a story about the students.
So great.
That's awesome. That'll be in the book.
Anybody else have any questions or want them to share? Go ahead.
What does TG stand for?
The good.
Yeah.
It actually doesn't stamp anything, because I was a record executive at RCA, and I was thinking, here I am recording from Motown. They conflict with each other. I'm drawing a paycheck from RCA as a record executive, but I'm recording for Berry Gordy at Motown. If RCA finds out, I'm losing my job. And I needed my job. So I just sat down one night and I just thought, well, initials are pretty cool. B.J. Thomas, it got a good name, and C.W. McCall, and Tom T. Hall. Mm-hmm. I said, I think I'll just go with initials. And I just sat down and took a pen and wrote a T and a G and Sheppard, and that was it. And it just happened. That's where the name
actually
came. My real name is Bill Browder. Mm-hmm. Yeah. They always knew me as Bill. Until I became TG, but I think I was always TG Sheppard, but it just took the record business to bring that side of me out. You know? That's the way it happened.
And I guess just like Conway was a third person.
Oh yeah, and Harold Jenkins was his name.
He always referred to Conway as a third person.
Yes,
so.
Yes.
I learned that from Joni Lee, by the way.
You did.
Michelle, I've got to talk to you because from Canada, you've had a huge string of number one records, and in the Canadian Country Music Hall of Fame. And
Entertainer.
So many accolades and all that. Of all your big hit records, is there any one that resonates with you, or that you have a special connection or a story you'd like to share?
Well, Take It Like a Man definitely is the song. Thank God I love that song, right? Because I actually have a couple of number ones that I didn't necessarily want to record, but in the record business, there's a give and a take a little bit. You know, the record label will come with a song that they think might be, you know, a hit, and maybe you relate to it, maybe you don't, but if you give me that one, I give you that one, kind of, you know. And so, thank God, I love Take It Like a Man. I can't wait to sing that every night at the end of the night. So that was very special. And then I put out a song called He Would Be 16.
Oh yeah.
Which is about a mother who gave up her child for adoption. And it's very special and very unique, and certainly unique at that time in the format. And I really debated whether or not to record it, because I have never been pregnant or had children. And everything I record is something that comes from my own life story. To record something that I've never done or don't relate to just doesn't work for me, you know. So I was really uncertain about recording He Would Be 16. But I brought the song out live to the audience before I recorded it. And because, you know, we're out there doing festivals, and I kind of was rocking the stage and jumping off of drum risers and running out to the audience, and that was sort of how I performed, and not so much these days, because, you know. But although, by God, I'm working on lifting those weights again. It's in the back of my mind. The thought is there, but, you know, when you're young, you know, as an athlete. So when I came to the stage, I had my little tight cat suits on and my cowboy boots, and would run around the stage. So that story and that song was really not in my thought process as a performer, to bring the show from woohoo to this subject matter. So I brought it out live, and the response was unimaginable. And the first time I performed it was in some festival somewhere, and I was at the autograph table signing autographs afterwards. And this lady comes up to me with tears in her eyes, and every time I tell these stories, it gets me. And she said, "I just brought my husband under the bleachers, and I told him for the first time that I'd given up a boy for adoption." She told him for the first time that song inspired her to do that. So that was back in 1992, and I released that song. And just a couple of weeks ago when I was doing a show, out afterwards in the autograph lineup, and this young man comes up, young man now, he's, you know, 30-something probably now, 30, and he said, my family never understood why my mother would play, he would be 16 on the piano all the time. She'd be playing the song in the house and they would wonder, what in the world is, why is mom connecting to this song? Well, he then found, he was adopted. He was her son. I'm getting the goosebumps right now. And he finally was brought, introduced to his mother and her family. And her family, who was his family, right, said, you know what, mama would play, he would be 16 on the piano all the time, and it's because of you. And then this guy just told me this story a couple of weeks ago. So here we are with a song I released in 1992 that still resonates like that,
music,
right?
Wow.
Yeah. So those two songs are very special for me, and I'm thankful that I got to be the artist to record them.
Yeah, we're blessed to have had those
you had a
gifts.
I have a question for you. What was the first song you wrote when you were six?
I knew it. How can I get a copy of it?
I'm getting it right here.
It's a classic, I can tell you.
Okay, so a little six-year-old, give me some grace here, okay? I was in the bathtub and I was in water. Just hit me, okay? In the bathtub.
So
and it was Delta Dawn was really big at the time, you know, it was on the radio all the time. And I just happened to look at the faucet and it said Delta Faucet. And I'm like, so Delta Dawn, push for shower, then you're gone. Push up open and you'll see that it will run. Push for C and you will freeze. Push for H and you will burn. Push up both of them and you will be a mixed up person.
So she's a prodigy, okay?
There you go.
You still want to write?
Yes, ma'am. In your pool. There's nobody, no cameras.
No cameras.
Okay,
all right.
Okay,
those she are forbidden in my pool.
You can see my watermill every night.
Well, I'll make up for it with commissions on what I write.
There you go.
Right? Yes. Well. We appreciate your time, and we're going to give them a couple minutes to go. Does anybody have any other quick questions? Go ahead.
I have two things for you, not a question. Watching you play the guitar, Kathy Mateo is one of the finest guitar players I've ever heard in my life.
Right.
You have that same touch.
Thank you so much.
And TG, I met in North Wiltsboro Speedway back in the 1980s. And you sponsored a car, and I'm having a senior moment to remember whose car it was.
Jim Richmond.
Jim Richmond.
Yes.
Okay.
I had my
and Folgers. Was it Folgers?
I had the Folgers NASCAR team for 8 years.
Right. Okay.
And
Kenny Schrader.
Jim Richmond. Ken Schrader.
Right.
Martin was my driver.
Yay.
I was a big NASCAR guy for years. And then I wound up writing part of the Folgers commercial, you know, the best part of waking up.
Wow.
So the association there was really great for ever, you know, with the Folgers. So it was Tim Richards.
Okay.
Probably.
I have a question.
Yeah.
TG, promise us you're going to write that book.
Oh, I am.
Oh,
I've already, Kelly got on me so bad about this. She said, you know, if something happens to you, these stories will be gone and no one will hear them. And so, you know, I kept thinking, well, it's time.
Yeah.
I never wanted to do the book because I didn't feel my life was completed yet. Mm-hmm. And although I still feel that, there's a lot that I've done that I really should document. So
before you start forgetting,
and you are. but I started outlining the chapters this past week or so. I look back over all this and I'm going, like, was I really doing this? Did I really do this? You know, it's amazing to when you see it all written out.
There's a couple of chapters I'm not excited about in writing, and I won't read them, but they have to be put in there, you know?
Yes, of course.
Some things are important.
Interesting, yeah.
Oh, and it'll be a positive book. It won't be a negative book at all.
Well, I know where all of us in the room are looking forward to that, that's for sure.
I'd like a real quick response because I know you guys are recording together.
Today?
Today.
Yeah.
So we've got a little bit of a schedule. I do know that you've got a, you want to tell us a little bit about what to expect with the album?
Well,
with
our duet album?
Yeah, we did a duet album called Iconic Duets a few years ago, and it did very well, and Time Life picked it up, and it just, and so we thought, well, maybe it's time to do a sequel to our duet album. So we're about 3/4 of the way through that, and it'll be out probably Valentine's Day of next year, our duet album.
Yeah. And then I'm recording a song today for finalizing my album that I think is Jesus is on.
And it's called, the album's called Dragonfly.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Very nice.
She's recording.
And I love your version of Quando, Quando, Quando.
I do too. Oh.
Yes. Yeah.
And I got a chuckle out of TG on an interview one time because I'm one of the last surviving people that love his song, Don't Ya?
Oh, you are. Man.
So you're the one.
That's what he said on the interview. You're the one. So, all right. We're going to give everybody a chance, get them a chance to go to their tables. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you.
We're glad.
Now, when are y'all leaving town?
Wednesday morning.
Wednesday morning.
Yeah.
I want to share one thing. I appreciate you bringing my book for me. I brought a few with me, not for everyone, obviously, but I'm an 18-year breast cancer survivor, yes. And I'm really grateful to be able to say that. And the book that you have brought to me is what I wrote. It's my story about my chapters and how I navigated through the music business, yes, but going through breast cancer, but 18 years of survivalship, I've got a lot to say. And Olivia Newton-John wrote the foreword to my book, so a lot of my the positive ways I learned to live was from her, so her advice is sprinkled through the book. So if any of you guys know somebody going through that, it might be a gift that you might want to bring back for someone.
And my mom had breast cancer, so I could really relate.
Oh, I'm sure you can.
Yeah.
My mom did too.
I think everybody's been.
Did you know that in every chapter of that, there's a QR code?
Yes.
That you can take your phone and it takes you to videos at the end of every chapter just to document what was just said.
Oh, that is cool.
Yeah.
So anyway, sorry.
No, that's fine. So we'll give them a chance to get to the table and get their merchandise and everything. You can talk with them individually and just
take photos.
Yeah.
Whatever y'all want to do. We're here for y'all.
Yep.
Thank you so much.
Thank y'all.
Are you ready to hear? Yes.